Welcome back to Guru Talk. I'm Dave Palumbo, and by popular demand, we got a man back who was super popular a couple weeks ago. We talked about testosterone and aromatase inhibitors, and people just couldn't get enough of them. So, Jay Campbell, welcome back to the show.
Dave, man, thank you for having me, man. It's an honor.
Yeah, well, Jay, you know, there was a topic that, you know, you had mentioned to me, and it kind of struck a chord because a lot of people always ask me about it, and I've talked about it before. It's fasting. You know, fasting almost sounds like a sacrilegious word to bodybuilders because all we do is pump food into our mouths because we want to get bigger and bigger and bigger. So the question is, you know, how does fasting fit into a bodybuilding's regimen? Now, I usually recommend that guys once a year do this 3-week detox that I've developed. It involves fasting 12 hours out of the day to give your digestive tract a chance to kind of detoxify itself. And I found that it's rather than do like a quick fast over like 5 or 7 days, this is over a 3-week period of time. Now you have implemented some sort of fasting into your regimens, you know, on a regular basis. So explain to me what your understanding of fasting is, and some of the I know you're a research maniac. What you found out from all the data you've gone through.
Yeah, so all good, really good points. So I wrote a book with my ex-business partner, still best friend, Jim Brown, called The Metabolic Blowtorch Diet, which we should have called it The Metabolic Blowtorch Lifestyle, because as you know, a diet is a scam word for for frat people. But it's basically an alternate day fasting routine. So you basically create the lifestyle around your training regimen, right? So if you're a bodybuilder and you train 5 days a week in some form of a split, then you would be fasting 2 days and eating on your training days.
Gotcha.
If you're, you know, like me or you, and now it's just about wellness and life extension and longevity, you know, we train 2 or 3 days a week, whatever, just to maintain, then you would probably fast 3 or 4 days and train and eat. So it's kind of a balance between, with all the research, like you said, yes, I'm very familiar with the research. We'll talk about that in a second. But all the research shows that if you train fasted, you are not going to get the maximum benefits of autophagy and all the other life extension things, obviously fat loss, insulin suppression and those things. Because as you know, when you train fasted, you increase insulin and you increase the mediated response of growth hormone and a bunch of other things too, which can, like, you know, put you into a state that you don't want to be, which can obviously lead to being catabolic and whatnot. And we'll talk about that. But in my opinion, today, there's so much nonsense going around on the internet, as you know, about somebody should do this type of diet versus a keto diet versus a low carb diet versus the zone diet versus this, and all that. And, you know, my whole take on all of it is that you should be metabolically flexible.
Yep.
And obviously I steal that from, you know, our friend, the great Charles Poliquin, and now Benjamin Brown is kind of carrying on his work with that. But, you know, metabolic flexibility, very simply, Dave, all that means is you fuel your body based on its unique energy demand. So if you're a bodybuilder, you got to eat carbs. Okay. If you think the opposite of that, and I know you were very big on the keto diet, and I know there's guys out there that are using keto diets and bodybuilding. And if you have the right type of genetics, maybe you can get away with it. But I think we all come to the realization that to truly build muscle and replenish glycogen in the most effective fashion, you have to re-glycogenate through carbohydrate ingestion.
Yeah. And I only advocate ketogenic dieting, you know, off pre-contest. I don't advocate it to put muscle on, because I think that the carbs definitely spare, obviously.
And by the way, that is metabolic flexibility right there.
Yeah.
You use a diet based on the unique wants and needs of that individual for whatever his end game is. That's it. It's that simple.
So how do you fast? How many hours a day when you do your fast do you do it?
Yeah, so it's a good question. It obviously comes down to like what my goal is. My wife and I just got back from Cabo San Lucas last week. So I did like a 2 week prior to going down there so I could be really lean. I did 4 days a week fasting. So I would train on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, which is what normally what I do. Some days I have a fourth day of training, just depends on schedule and life, you know. But normally the metabolic blowtorch diet is set up for 4 days of fasting and 3 days of training.
Now, when you say fasting, how many days, how many hours are you fasting?
Good question. So fasting, and this is where most people get confused, especially with all the gurus and people out there that claim that, you know, 16 hours is fasting versus eight hour eating window. 16 hours is not fasting, okay? All of the research conclusively proves it's not fasting for fat loss. Is it fasting meaning you're not eating for maintenance? Sure. If you're a relatively lean person, athlete, performance person, bodybuilder, conditioned person, whatever, and you want to not eat for 16 hours and then eat in an 8-hour window, are you going to probably gain fat? No, you're probably going to maintain your condition. But if you're somebody who's looking to fast for actual fat loss to tighten up, then you got to go longer. And again, the book that we wrote, The Blowtorch Diet, which, by the way, I give away for free. All you have to do is send an email to my team. It's contact@trtrevolution.com. We will send you that book. And I also send out the testosterone Bible too. And by the way, Dave, I got so many people that came from you. So I'm so appreciative. I mean, we had thousands of people that.
Wow. Really? Okay. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah. No, dude, honestly, thousands. I'm not kidding you. So many of the books are out in public now, which is
cool.
Great.
That's what we want.
So the book though, to back to your question, essentially, if you're going to fast for fat loss, the research shows that you have to get into 18 and 20 and even longer from an hour of not eating. And when I say not eating, I mean nothing. I mean water, black coffee, nothing with any kind of energy or caloric demand in it. So you cannot be eating, you know, branched chain amino acids, which people always ask about, yeah, or other things, because again, it's protein. Yeah. So you gotta not eat. But when you get into the 18, 19, 20 and longer hours, this is when the biochemical cascade occurs in the body that, you know, increases fight or flight hormones. And they are specifically called catecholamines, right? You know what they are. They're norepinephrine, right. Epinephrine. There's a couple other ones. But when you release those, your body is basically being stimulated in the very low blood flow areas, which is fat resistant areas, right? Like hips, buttocks, abdominal, sapralic, you know, lower ab region. And so you get a lot of fat loss in the areas that you're prone to hold it that are very resistant to fat loss. Now, most people freak out and they say, yeah, but then you're going to go catabolic, bro, and you're going to have muscle loss and blah, blah, blah. That is complete BS. So I look to the research of Dr. Jason Fung. Okay. He's written The Obesity Code and he's written an amazing book on fasting, which I used a lot of his research in my book. But he basically shows that a conditioned performance sprinter, okay, went 78 hours before there was one single ounce of muscle loss. Now, this person, by the way, was anthropomorphically measured at 6% body fat when they did this test. So think about how long that is. This is a person who's extremely conditioned. And by the way, this is like a world record sprinter.
Yeah.
So a very muscular, hypermuscular person, very low body fat. He went 77 hours of fasting before they measured 1 ounce of actual muscle protein or muscle kinase protein loss.
Let me just stop you for a second. I think that that's a terrible way to do an experiment because those guys, I've worked with bodybuilders who, I'm telling you, genetically freaky bodybuilders that I would put on a bikini diet. I mean, these guys were eating less food than the bikini competitors and they weren't losing weight. Okay, yep. I had to starve them to lose weight because their bodies just want to retain because they're anabolic machines. So you put me on 78 hours without any kind of food and just drinking water, I would lose 20 pounds of muscle. I guarantee it.
Bodybuilders are a complete, super physiologic 1% mesomorphic mutants they're not, you can't compare them. This was just, again, a sprinter, you know what it is. It's like a 5'8" black guy. It's probably 190, muscular pack guy. Again, just a sprinter. But the research for that guy showed that there was no muscle loss at all in the 77 hours. But the bottom line is that most people, and you know this, average people, guys that go to the gym to train, are not going to lose muscle at a day, 36 hours, whatever, of not eating. And again, it's a mindset that most people think that they do. I have thousands of people who have done the diet, right? We put the diet out. It's 2 years old now. We put the diet out in 2017 in September. But like my inner circle of people was kind of using like a makeshift version of it before we really sat down and put it out there since 2014. So we've had thousands of people, bodybuilders, fitness competitors, you know, moms and dads, Joe Sixpack used the diet. And I've never really seen anybody not do well on it. Now, again, I don't have professional bodybuilders that I'm coaching. Yeah. And I'm not, and obviously as like you, I would never recommend this type of diet for somebody like that who's conditioned and obviously needs to feed the furnace. Mm-hmm. But I have seen people in their 30s and 40s who are very, very stubborn or resistant to any kind of fat loss.
Right.
You know, who are doing ketogenic diets. They were doing, modified, low carb type stuff. Who, when they started fasting for 20 hours a day, okay, 2 or 3 days a week, were blown away at the fat loss, again, from the resistant areas.
Do you think, here's my theory on that. I'm going to give you my theory. I don't have any data to prove it, but I have empirical data that I witnessed with my client. I believe that there's basically three ways that the body can detoxify itself when it gets overflown with toxins. One way is through the skin, okay? The body starts releasing a lot. That's how greasy Italians get rid of their toxins. And you know what? When I would be toxic from whatever bodybuilding drugs I was doing and overeating of food, and I would break out a lot. I get a lot of acne.
Yep.
And I know that, and when I stopped eating as much food as I was eating, even though I was still on the anabolics, I my skin got much clearer. So I know that when toxins overload in my body, I get rid of it through the skin. The other way that people can get rid of it is through the stomach. You know these people. They constant acid reflux, overly acidic stomach, to the point where they might have chronic hiccups, I've seen in bodybuilders.
Yep.
Because that acid is overstimulating that nerve that innervates the diaphragm, the phrenic nerve. So the third way I see is that some people are stores of toxins. In other words, they have a lot of body fat, and their body puts the toxins into the fat cells and just stores them. Hey, the fat's sitting there anyway. Let's put the freaking toxins in there as well. Those people seem to be very resistant to losing fat. And when you put those people on a fast, okay, 20 hours a day, even 12 or 18 hours a day, it gives them, and the body doesn't have to digest anything and process.
Right.
The body starts releasing these toxins out of their body. And when the toxins finally leave all those fat cells, this is my theory at least, now they're able to lose fat. Because let's face it, you've been to Jersey. When you drive through Jersey, it stinks, right? Because there's a ton of dumped garbage and all the garbage dumps there. Okay, there's no way you can build luxury condominiums until you clean up that garbage, right? You're not going to build them on top of that. And I think that's how the body works. I think if there's too much toxins being stored in the body will resist losing fat in certain areas where it's storing them.
Dave, I think you're a genius because Anthony Jay, okay, who's a very close personal friend of mine now, who wrote this book, Estrogeneration, the Mayo Clinic researcher, says the same thing.
Oh, really?
And in our theory, which a couple of doctors I'm working with right now, because we've created our own theory called testosterone resistance syndrome, TRS. Mm. It's the same shit, okay? Basically, we are living in a toxic soup bowl, okay? People, as you know, are being annihilated by the food they eat, the air they breathe, the plastic, the blue light, bro, right? This is creating chemicals. So the bottom line is you're right, dude. I mean, again, this is not being mentioned by medicine. It's not accepted.
Right.
There's no data. There's some data. He's pulling the data out. He says there is data. He says the EPA suppresses the data.
I'm sure they do.
Because by the way, Dave, this is you have no idea like how smart you really are, because the truth is that there's cross linking too. So imagine these horrifying chemicals that our body already has to deal with, and like you said, has to distill, has to deaminate, has to push through the system, somehow detoxify. So the truth is that fasting is exactly what you said it is. And what you said it is from the scientific nerd statement is autophagy, right? Because that's what autophagy is. It's a form of senescence. It's literally a fumigation of the cellular, degradant or contaminants and then pushing it out. So yes, you're a fat person. You work a shift job in a chemical factory. You are legitimately every single day for 10 hours being annihilated and you have no idea. You have no idea. You're 20% fat. You got all that visceral fat in your stomach.
Yep.
You're right, Dave. Those are all noxious chemical particulates sitting in the visceral fat.
And you can get, you don't need to be in a chemical plant to get them. You could eat a bag of Chips Ahoy cookies and get them in there as well. Or a pint of Häagen-Dazs ice cream, or, you know what I mean? You don't need to go sit in a nuclear power plant to have toxins in your body.
It's unbelievable.
And you know what? When you release those toxins, you better be taking a good fiber supplement. That's why I advocate everyone take FiberLyze, because when you release those toxins, you don't want to get them reabsorbed. When you start releasing, yeah, you know, when you first did your first fast, you probably felt like you were in La La yeah. Land, because the toxins yeah. make you feel almost like you're nuts. Your brain doesn't know what's going on at first, you know?
Yep. No, you're 100% right. And this is, you know, goes back to our first podcast together when you said that the key was being lean, right? So, I mean, again, in all causes, every example, no matter what we talk about, you know, whether it's hormone optimization, whether it's fasting, if you maintain a level of leanness worth, you know, you have obviously very minimal to no visceral fat. Yeah. Most of this shit's not going to affect you.
No.
But as you know, the average guy walking around today drinking beer, you know, eating an Americanized, modernized diet, bro, you get 20% body fat and all of it, right, is right here.
Yep. You're right.
Those guys are chemical bombs. Mm-hmm. Literally, like, dude, this is such a big topic because those are the guys, and we didn't talk about this on the first contest, but I'll just throw this in there. Those are the guys who, when they inject testosterone, you know, TRT, doesn't matter the dose.
Yeah.
Dude, their body has a massive cytokine pushback, which causes the inflammatory response, which causes all of those side effects that they believe are high estrogen side effects, which you and I know are not.
No, yeah, you're right. I agree with you. I agree.
That's it.
Yeah, you know how you know that that's true? You give them 2 Tylenol, and all the symptoms go away because just it like inhibits that. The production of all those prostaglandins
exactly.
and all that stuff. And they're like, wow, I wonder how that happened.
That's absolutely true, bro.
Right?
By the way, no one's ever said that before, but that's we should focus there just for 1 second because that is absolutely the truth. You literally just stop prostaglandin production, and boom, their inflammatory response cessates and it goes away. But, you know, what does a doctor do? They call their doctor, oh my God, my nipples. And then boom, he's on them, you know, high dose of Remax.
Right.
Toast. Yeah, dude.
Yeah, but I will tell you one thing, Jay, you scared the crap out of everyone with aromatase inhibitors. Now I have like 4,000 people texting me and emailing me.
You have
me.
No idea. I mean, I'll send you a link to, if you haven't seen it, I did, you know, the presentation with Dr. Komenaric that he did at AMMG. And he's got all the data now. He's got all the DEXA scans. He's got thousands of guys that with DEXA scans. Uh-huh. And it's, dude, I'm telling you, man, that shit is really bad. Bad news.
I just want to just preface for people who are on like 1,500 or 2,000 milligrams of gear a week, you don't stop taking your aromatase inhibitors.
Yeah, you have to do it. No, I mean, it's true.
You're talking
about
HRT. You're taking about HRT levels, and I agree with you.
Absolutely. I mean, look, as I said on the first podcast, the bottom line is, and you already know this, dude, I'm not telling you anything. Mm-hmm. The bottom line is, if you're using super physiologic levels of anything, all bets are off when it comes to health, yeah. right? It's going to come down to genetics and biochemical individuality. Some guys can do whatever and are fine. I mean, you are probably one of those guys, bro. I mean, look, you 13 years, you were 300 plus pounds, shredded, and now you're a normal bro, and you have no health issues. You know, maybe minor here and there, but there's probably due to aging.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I mean, another guy takes 1 milligram of Arimidex with 500 milligrams of testosterone for 6 years and croaks.
Yeah. Well, you know, and it's also, there's a genetic component too, that, you know, some people are genetically vulnerable to some of these drugs too. That's the scary part. You don't know who you are. If your genetics are such that if you take a certain drug, it's going to have a bad reaction in your body. Whereas the other guy, you know, we see these people, they smoke, you know, 4 packs of cigarettes a day, never get lung cancer, never get emphysema. Fine. We know people that drink their whole life, like these rock stars, and they live to 90, you know, so. Right. Everyone's body processes chemicals differently, and I think
let's stay there because this is important, and I think we can clear a lot of stuff up. So let's say you are one of those bodybuilders. Okay, you don't give a shit. You're gonna play Russian roulette. You don't know. There's really, and by the way, you know you can get your genetics analyzed with Dr. J, and there's other people out there, and Dr. J can tell you about your, your anabolic receptor sensitivity.
Yeah.
Everything. He can pretty much look at everything now. But let's just say you're one of those guys and you're watching the show and you're you know, like, what do? I'm not going to stop taking 500 milligrams plus a week of tests.
Yeah.
You have to get your coronary ultrasound of your neck, you know, your carotid arteries. You need to look at some vascular pathways, you get an MRI, and you should literally do that once a year Because like you said, that's the only way you're going to actually somewhat understand your genetic correlation and what your potential is for, you know, overgrowth, hypertrophy, all of that stuff.
Right. No, you're right. You're right. Let's get back to fasting for a minute. Now,
sure.
How long are you going to do these fasts for? I mean, do you recommend doing it for 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 20 weeks, 6 months, the rest of your life? I mean, how do you structure that?
I mean, it's a great question. I really think it comes down to your lifestyle goals, who you are, what's your age, your job. I mean, for me, dude, fasting is my life.
Really? You know, so you do it all the time?
This is literally my life. Like today I will eat whatever I want, whenever I want. Again, I'm not eating Mountain Dew and Doritos, right? Yeah. But I mean, I eat clean. But on my training days, I know that those are my days to relax, to live life, go to a restaurant, enjoy a nice meal. You know, I don't drink alcohol, obviously, for consciousness reasons. But I mean, I'm not against alcohol. As I wrote in my book, you know, we know the research shows that 4 ounces of wine, you know, red or white wine a night is filterable by the kidneys and also pushed out, you know, through the conversion of triglycerol to but you can drink 4 ounces of wine a night.
I'm doing it. Okay. Jay, I've added that to my regimen since I've had kids. I do my red wine at night.
That's awesome. Listen, four ounces of wine a day is completely acceptable biologically by the human body. It's not going to cause serious issues. Now, if you're doing it for a consciousness standpoint, it might suppress your consciousness a slight bit. Again, you're biochemically unique. You may be different than me, but if you're just drinking it for health purposes, it's fine.
Yeah.
But you know, beyond that,
de-stressing too, I'm taking it.
No, of course. I mean, you know, again, lifestyle, there's obviously always benefits to certain things. It's all about moderation.
Yeah.
But
I know what the truth is, Jay, I don't need it, but I've convinced myself that there is some health benefits to it, and it does. It does, at the end of the day, now I understand why my dad had to drink wine when I was a kid.
Listen, I personally believe that whatever takes the edge off for a person that then doesn't do, obviously, physiological harm, you know, biochemically to that person and that to others is fine. Yeah. I literally choose not to drink just for consciousness. Yeah. I feel like if I drink at all, it just lowers my consciousness. Yeah. And if I did do it, and I have a glass of wine with my wife all the time.
Yeah.
And people are going to be like, you're drinking wine, bro. But I mean, I've started to do it because, you know, I'm 48 now and I'm not getting any younger. And my wife enjoys a glass of wine now and then. So we'll do it. But but back to your thing. So I personally now am so used to, I call it fast adapted, that I can go 3 or 4 days a week fasting for 20 hours a day.
Wow.
And if I want to get ripped, if I want to go to a beach or wherever and just be complete six pack, and you know, I'm not a bodybuilder, but I'm, you know, when I'm shredded, I'm like 209, 210 pounds. And I, you know, I have good muscularity. I've been as big as like 230 in my life and I'm 6'1", not a little under 6'1". Not, you know, super freak, but I mean, I look good. But bottom line is you just moderate or modulate fasting relative to your lifestyle condition. So my opinion, if you get used to fasting, say 2 or 3 days a week, and then you know you train on the days that you eat, you can easily modulate it with, like I said, a 2 week switch to 4 days a week of fasting, long fast. Dude, I even go, and a lot of people know this, like I will now go, if I train Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and I'm fasting to get ripped, I will literally not eat on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Now,
so I will wake up.
You won't eat anything.
Nothing. I will wake up, so I'll drink water with caffeine in it, electrolytes, you know, no calories. I will drink coffee, black coffee. I also have a green tea formulation that I have that has like really high, you know, what is it called? The tocopherol stuff. But I will wake up early in the morning the next day and I will eat at like, say, between 5 and 5:30, a nice big bowl of oatmeal with protein usually in it. And then I will have like a pre-drink with this, which Perfect Amino from this guy down by you. I don't know if you, I need to introduce you to this guy, by the way, Dr. Minkoff. Do you know this guy, Dr. David Minkoff?
Yeah, I know who he is, yeah. I don't know him personally, but I've heard the name, yeah.
Okay, so anyway, his protein formulation is amazing. You know, you can take a really low dose, you get like the perfect essential amino acid blend. And then I drink a pre-shake. So I probably get like 100 to 150 grams of carbohydrates before I actually train.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's in my system. And then I have a good training session and then I eat probably anything I want that day. I mean, I think probably I average about 3,000 to 3,500 calories on my training days.
You know, do you get hungry in the days that you don't eat anything?
I'm sorry?
Are you hungry on the days that you don't eat anything?
No. So it's a great question. So in my book, Guaranteed Shredded, which is the newest book, which is like the super advanced hacker's guide to fasting from the first book. Mm-hmm. I give like a supplement regimen. I sent you the book, right? You have
yeah.
it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I have like a really dialed in, like high level biohacker, neurohacker supplement guide of like, this is what you do to not be hungry. So in my opinion, when you become fast adapted, and you talked a little bit about that metabolic toxins release. So mm-hmm. once you become fast adapted, most of the bad stuff in the biome, the microbiota, is neutralized. Now, obviously, metformin for life extension purposes and also for cleansing the microbiome is huge. Now, again, bodybuilders will come and they'll say, well, you know, it inhibits mTOR and it's probably not great. And by the way, I did a podcast with Stan Efferding, and you know Stan. Stan's yeah. great. And Stan is very anti-metformin for strongmen for its glucose inhibition properties. He's like, you know, a strongman needs to be able to have massive glucose utilization. And I totally agree with him. But if you're just an average guy trying to look better naked, training hard, and you're on, you know, testosterone optimization therapy, therapeutic testosterone, metformin, the limitations of metformin through mTOR are like transient and minimal in comparison to all the anti-aging and life extension and longevity effects that metformin gives you. So to answer your question though too, metformin pushes your insulin signal so low when you become fast adapted that you don't get hungry. Mm-hmm. You will not get hungry at all. I don't know a single real faster, even guys like big guys, you know, like when Jim Brown does our diet, he's a big dude, you know, he's 260 and probably maybe even more. He's somewhere between 260 and 270 and, you know, sub 10% body fat. He'll go 20 hours and be fine. He has no hunger.
When you go 20 hours of fasting, what do you eat in those 4 hours? And when do you usually eat the food, in the morning or at night?
It's a great question. And that, again, this is all covered in the book, of course, but, it just depends. For me, if the goal is to be shredded, fuck dude, I have, as I was telling you, like I'll have like a shake. I mean, well, I could use your macadamia oil now
yeah,
too, but
exactly.
You know, I would have like a protein shake with a really good essential amino acid blend, with either, you know, MCT oil or really, really pure virgin olive oil or the macadamia oil or something like that, and probably pound two or three of those, you know, in a 4 or 5 hour window before I go to bed. And
right.
that way I'm getting probably 1400 to 1600 calories and I'm getting, you know, easily 200 plus grams of protein. And I'm definitely not going to go to bed feeling that I'm hungry or didn't get enough calories that day to maintain my current body weight or my body fat percentage.
So you'll do it at night. So you're doing the eating at night.
Mostly. So yeah, okay. So it's a good question. So like normally if I eat, like last night I ate, right? Like I hadn't for 2 weeks before. I just didn't eat Tuesdays and Thursdays. But last night I ate and I picked up my wife. We had to go see somebody. And I ate at like 7:15 and then I ate again at like 8:30. And then I was up until like 11 and I ate something again at like 10:30. So I eat like almost every 90 minutes to 2 hours.
Okay.
But sometimes I don't. Like, you know, other times I'll just have a nice big meal.
Right. And that's it for the whole day.
Yeah, that's it. But I think it's a good question because if you're a fat person and you're trying to lose body fat, right, and you're already probably a little bit insulin resistant and you have so much high, you know, you have a lot of visceral body fat, so we know you're inflamed, you shouldn't eat, you know, a big thick meal at night because obviously it's going to stimulate your metabolism. It's going to keep you awake. You're going to have all those, you know, ghrelin and all those other hormones going through trying to digest the food. So you should eat something that's obviously incredibly low in carbs and also easily, you know, like you call it highly flammable in the digestive tract so that the body will digest it, you know, easily so you can sleep at night and not cause, you know, stomach upset or disruption.
Mm, interesting. Yeah. You know, I think a lot of people, well, let me give you a scenario. You got a guy who's very lean, who now wants to do the fasting for health purposes. So they're going to, where are these people getting their glucose? So if their glycogen stores are depleted, okay, where is the brain getting glucose from?
No, it's a good question. I mean, the brain will definitely create glucose from protein, you know,
right.
as you know, through a process called gluconeogenesis.
Right. So I just
did a podcast with this guy, right? You know, just give him a shout out, Dr. David Minkoff. He's brilliant. He's down in Florida. He's 72 years old. The guy's amazing, dude. And he basically was like, look, dude, I work with some of the highest level keto professional athletes in the world. And 90% of those guys are never even in ketosis because the body becomes so efficient at creating glucose from protein that they're really, you know, not in ketosis. And as you know, real ketosis is what, 83 or 84% fat and the rest protein and some carbs. I think the ratio, I think, is now 13%. And I think that's what Dominic D'Agostino is saying.
Jay, I don't think that there's a formula that works for that. I'll tell you why. Because if you're a bodybuilder and you're breaking down an enormous amount of protein in the gym, okay, an enormous amount of muscle in the gym, your protein requirement's way higher. Now, the keto guys would tell you, the ivory tower keto guys would tell you that if you eat all that protein, you're not going to be in ketosis. I don't believe that. I think that if you're eating moderate fat and high protein, most of that protein is getting used to repair all that muscle tissue you're breaking down.
So I agree, by the way. I agree 100%. Mm. I think, and I don't think we have a difference. I think you're right, because you said the ivory tower. I think that the quantification is really just blowing with, you know, they have that new ketone, really expensive thing. Yeah. So essentially, you're out of ketosis metabolically, but you're in ketosis thermically, which is what you're arguing for, which is what I agree.
No, but I mean, even your brain feels good. You know when you're in ketosis.
Yeah,
people always ask me, Dave, how do I know when I'm in ketosis? I use the strips. They never read anything. Right. I'm like, how does your brain feel? I feel great. My blood sugar is always stable. I'm like, then you're in ketosis. That means your brain is using fat. If you're not eating carbs,
I agree. It's semantics. When I did the ketosis diet, when I worked with Lyle McDonald when I'm back in my 20s, you know, I 33 years in a row, I was ketosis or ketotic. I was cyclical, targeted, and even Atkins-based, right? And this is before anybody really knew anything about ketosis.
Sure.
So I know a lot about it. And I was in that zone, and I've been there, and I'm very, very fat adapted dude, right? I have Northern Slavic, European, a lot of that ancestry. Right. Those dudes like that can go for a long time. You could probably go forever without eating, right, on a ketogenic diet, right?
Yeah. I feel great. My brain is great. But getting back to my question is that if you're super lean and you do a fast because you want to be healthy, whatever, and you want to live a long time, because we know it increases their sirtuins, and obviously that leads to, you know, to longevity and la da 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 da. What is your brain using for fuel? It's using glucose that's made from amino acids, but you're not eating any amino acids or protein. So where is it getting it? It's got to be cannibalizing muscle tissue.
No, I don't think it is. I mean,
where is it coming from then?
So it's coming from the protein. But
what protein? You're not eating. You're fasting.
But that's what I'm saying is, again, the research will show you. I'm telling you, there is research out there. And again, I know you could probably say, well, not for a pro bodybuilder, but we're just talking average Joe six pack. The research will show you that you do not have catabolysis. It does not happen.
Jay, where is these amino acids coming from?
The amino acids come from when you break your fast. I mean, they literally come. So what I'm saying is your body doesn't need amino acids at all until a certain point. And I think that that point is different from everybody because we're all biochemically unique. But I know for a fact, dude, I literally can go easily 60 plus hours with nothing. Uh-huh. First off, I feel amazing. We haven't even talked about BDNF, which I want to get to, right? So, so BDNF is brain-derived neurotrophic factor. That is the hormone and the chemical, you know, cascade in the synaptic pathways that is released, again, at this 20. Well, the research shows it's somewhere between 17 and a half and 23 hours is when you really get the first pike or peak. And then about 42 hours, you get a deeper one. That's when I talk about the spirituality aspect of fasting. So when you get to like 42 hours, between 42 and 46 hours, bro, I don't know what happens. I call it like the God effect. Like you literally, you can go outside in nature and you can feel, I have a lot of stories like this. You can feel like you're connected to the things flying around you, buzzing around you. It's really, really interesting. I don't know how else to describe it, you know, regardless of spiritual beliefs, but.
Well, the shamans all fasted, right?
Oh yeah, no, of course. But back to your question, I personally do not have any, and I've measured myself with calipers. I've done dunk tests. I've done, you know, the osmotic pressure. And I've also done the DEXA, which, by the way, the DEXA and the InBody and all those things, they have error margins of anywhere between 5 and 7%, especially too, is population is so obese now, the mean is increasing to fat.
Right.
So it's like you can't rely on that anymore. But, you know, DEXA will at least give you bone mineral density and composition. So I've done them all, and I have not lost any muscle at 60 hours of fasting.
Right.
So where is my body?
But you also eat carbs. So when you're eating carbs on the days you do eat, you're storing glycogen. So
absolutely.
And when you're fasting, you're not working out those days. So because you're not working out, you're really not depleting any more glycogen. So you do have glycogen that can be used as fuel to turn into glucose. I'm talking about people that maybe don't store glycogen so well. They don't eat a ton of carbs. They do a fast maybe they run out of, and there's, I guess the trick would be don't work out on those fast days, or you're going to, then you can deplete glycogen much quicker,
well, exactly.
And then you're probably
you
more likely
never,
to lose protein.
Ever train. Exactly,
okay.
Brother.
All right, I got you. That's exactly. An important point, Jay. We got to really, we got to drive this point home. You can't work out on days that you're fasting.
I mean, you can, but it's stupid.
Right.
And there's so many people that advocate training at like 16, 18 hour windows of fast because of the adrenaline, and you can break the fast and you get the branched chain amino acids. It's so stupid.
I know.
Like, I laugh when I see these like muscular people advocate going to the gym on 16, you know, to 18 hour depletion fast and train with ballistic movements. I mean, you are asking for literally apoptosis of this tissue, dude.
Yeah.
I mean,
plus,
it's so
you're
going
to get hurt because you're probably dehydrated because you can't retain
absolutely.
Tissue fluid. Yeah.
Absolutely. And as you know, like the people that, you know, the real high level keto guys, dorks, whatever you want to call them, you know, that's what they talk about. The differentiation is the muscle cell hydrated?
Right.
Because most people doing ketotic diets don't hydrate correctly.
No.
So you also put yourself in a massive position of exposure to be injured.
Right. That's why I tell people to make sure you always eat a lot of sodium in your diet when you're on a ketogenic diet.
Well, just like,
because,
you know, absolutely.
And then important. The advantages of a ketogenic diet for women who tend to bloat easy, they love the ketogenic diet because they don't hold any water on it.
Exactly. So. Yeah. Well, women are a whole other story. We could do a podcast on women another time and just talk about like all the horrors they deal with chemical castration, because you kind of already talked about it today. Mm. Any woman today who is, you know, in their, you know, like our wives' ages, you know, in their late 30s through their 50s who used birth control, man, they're
bad?
Chemically castrated, brother. That shit was a poison, a toxin.
Why is that, Jay?
So you know, again, I point to his research. Dr. Anthony Jay is doing a lot on this now, but he basically says, he points to the research that we now have with the fish in all of the great tributaries and streams and lakes, freshwater and saltwater in North America. All the fish are becoming feminized. It's insane. They're all becoming women.
Really?
So he extrapolates that data to say that, you know, look around at our species now. Look at all the young men of today, right? They're very feminized. They're very high estrogen body fat. They have high pitched voices. They have low testosterone for the most part. They have low energy, low drive, blah, blah, blah. He's saying it's the same thing. And his opinion and theory, which he has starting to prove now with research, is that the wash off and the runoff, brother, in the water supply from birth control products of the last 25 to 30 years is causing this second and third generation epigenetic effect in men.
Wow.
Which is, again, emasculation.
Yeah.
Feminizing men.
Crazy.
Yeah.
The women will rule the world, as they always say, right?
I think that's where they're going. Well, I mean,
you don't think
right now, bro. I got to go get my tinfoil hat and we can talk deeper. But yeah. I mean, it's really crazy, man. They're creating like this situation where like women are becoming men or being taught to become more like men and men are becoming more like women. It's a mess, dude.
What about, there's a big, huge transgender movement in this country. Do you think anything that's linked to anything?
Oh, absolutely. This is all linked 100% because if you think about it, if a man becomes less masculine, he becomes more confused. He gets closer to that, like, okay, what my sexual identification is. I don't feel one way or the other. There is some research, and again, Anthony points to this too, where the urogenital tract is narrowing. So they now know in the last 30 years that between the, you know, the anus and the man's testicles are narrowing. So that is clear proof that we are showing a feminization of masculine, or I'm sorry, XY chromosome in society.
Wow. I'm traumatized by all this information that's coming out, but it makes sense. The data would obviously seem to indicate that, huh?
Well, like you say too, you look around, right? You just play the Jay Campbell, Dave Palumbo look around effect. Go to any major city at a market, go to a mall, go to a big outdoor place and just look around, dude. The men are weak.
Controversial stuff we're talking about here, Jay.
It is controversial, but I mean, again, you know, is it because it's controversial? Are we not allowed to talk about it?
Right.
I mean,
no,
I always just
can
say,
talk
look
about
around.
Anything on this thing. Yeah, I think it's an interesting topic that people are afraid to broach because you know they're afraid they're going to get people upset about it, and I think in our society everyone is so worried about offending people that no one wants to even look into the reality of what could be happening. How do we fix the problem? Can we?
I mean, I don't know. I'm going to introduce you to Anthony. I think you should bring Anthony on your show because he's awesome. And he's, dude, he works for the Mayo Clinic, and they've already warned him off like two or three times. And he's already told me, he says, share this with anybody you talk about. He's like the lead researcher at the Mayo Clinic. Wow. When he first started bringing out his information. It's a woman. She's retiring. She might have already been retired because this is a year and a half ago conversation.
Wow.
He said, she said, Anthony, I will say this, and then that's all I'll ever get from me. They are making men women.
Wow.
Zipped up. That was it.
I think on that note, we should just end the show because it's such a potent statement, right?
It's pretty crazy. But let me just wrap up, recap on fasting. So if you're fasting for fat loss and you're a man or a woman, if you really want to take it to the next level, and you will see results, by the way, fast. I mean, within 30 days, you will have noticeable change to your body's anthropomorphic measurements. Fast as a woman, between 16 and 20 hours, and as a man, fast between 18 and 22 hours. Now, again, 22 hours. Well, what do I do, bro? I can't eat. It's only 2 hours left in the day. If you're fat, what's the goal? Is the goal to lose weight or to eat? Right?
Yeah.
Are you going to lose muscle mass by only eating, 750 calories in one meal before you go to bed? No, you're not. As long as you've been training and you have some experience in the gym, some athletic background, something, your body has the neurological, memory to not lose muscle. But again, I've done this with thousands of people now. I have not seen people lose muscle and freak out. Most people will lose body fat very, very quickly and efficiently. If you're just a guy like you were talking about, a lean guy, you go to the gym, you're a bodybuilder, just fast one day a week.
Yeah.
Just literally not eat for 20 hours or 17 or, I say 20. I like 20 because that's when autophagy is measured. Mm-hmm. So what is autophagy? Because we didn't really define it. Autophagy is literally like your body doing a fumigation of your cells. So when you're in autophagic response, your body like will have, you'll go to the bathroom, you'll defecate at a certain time without any food in your body for 24 hours because that's kind of the autophagic response. Like I'm so used to when I have to wake up in the middle of the night after I fast for, 24 hours and go to the bathroom and nothing comes out.
Yeah.
But it's like you sit down on the toilet and boom, that's the autophagic response that, your body is getting rid of the dead cells.
Uh-huh. Gotcha. So, interesting. Yeah, that's it. Very interesting stuff, Jay. I love it. I love when we talk about cutting edge material that no one's really addressing. And I'm going to get you back. We're going to come back because I know there's going to be more popular demand. We're going to find another controversial topic that we could talk about and we're going to explore it. And we're going to, maybe get into some finding out some new stuff. Now, the only thing I do want to bring up, okay, as a bodybuilder, first of all, any of my clients that are watching this, which is probably all of them, do not email me and text me that you want to ask me about the fasting. If you're getting ready for a show, we're not doing any fasting, okay?
No.
Don't ask me about it. If you want to talk about it afterwards to detox, that's fine. Don't talk to me about it while you're contest dieting.
And let me just support
you. You guys know who you are out there. I know all the troublemakers who are going to be texting me about this.
Robert, let me support you. I do not ever recommend that anyone competing at any form of a competitive level, and that's whether pro or high amateur or ever, would ever fast to lose for a show, to get on stage. You've got to reglycogenate. You've got to do a lot of things with maintaining salt and mineral balance. Yeah. Dave is a super, super level professional. I've worked with guys like Dave. I look at Stan Efferding, also very much like Dave.
Yeah.
None of those guys would ever put a person in a, caloric deficit for that type of level. So yes, I do not advocate any of that either. So I just want to make that clear.
But having said that, the information that was provided was phenomenal. For people who have really resistant fat loss, this might be the solution you've been looking for. If they want to pick up those free books from you, give us the contact again, Jay.
Yeah, for sure. So if you want the Metabolic Blowtorch Diet or the TOT Bible, and as you know, Dave, the TOT Bible is 600 pages.
Yeah.
Anyone, man or woman, can get benefit out of it. We also do a lot of stuff on agents of change. So all the peptides and the new stuff is all measured in there and researched. You send me an email, contact@TRT. So Tom Roger Tom, Tom Roger Tom, Testosterone Replacement Therapy.com. I'm sorry, trtrevolution.com. My team will send you the book. If you want the newest, super advanced deluxe, on trend, GuaranteedShredded.com is the newest book that I put out earlier in this year, and it's very, very advanced for, I would say somebody who's already fast adapted and has been living an intermittent fasting lifestyle for a way. It's a way to really, really lower your body fat in a short amount of time.
All right. That's great information, Jay. Thank you for coming on again. Have a great day. Have a nice big meal tonight, and we'll talk
right
to you
now,
in a few weeks.
As soon as I hang up.
Yeah. All right, guys. And that's going to take us to the end of another Guru Talk with Dave Palumbo and Jay Campbell. We'll see you next time.